In this table, we want to look at the various chemical classes of hormones. Number one, so we can see what they're derived from in their production. Number two, so that we can look at their chemical characteristics, which is a major determinant of how they will interact with target cells. So we start here on the left. We have the amino acid-derived hormones. And there are actually only two different amino acids that are used as precursor. In reality, we could probably focus largely on one of them. That's tyrosine. And tyrosine is an amino acid that can be utilized to produce two different groups of hormones. Number one, tyrosine can be enzymatically modified to produce the catecholamines. This group is produced by the adrenal medulla, where these molecules, some of these molecules, are released as hormones. But it's also a process found in some neurons that utilize these agents as neurotransmitters. So again, pointing to the idea that it's not the chemical itself that determines the type of cell-cell communication, right? A neurotransmitter of norepinephrine and a hormone of norepinephrine is the same molecule, right? It's a mode of delivery that differs. Regardless, our tyrosine can be modified first to dopamine, which then gets largely converted to norepinephrine. And then in the adrenal medulla, most of that gets converted to epinephrine, commonly known as adrenaline. Note that these are all hydrophilic hormones, which means that they will bind to membrane-bound receptors, right? They cannot enter the cell to initiate their actions. Tyrosine is also utilized as a precursor to the thyroid hormones. The thyroid hormones are actually derived from a larger protein where the tyrosines are combined in pairs known as dimers. And then they become iodinated, add iodine atoms, and you can either add one or two per tyrosine, and they're in dimers. So we can end up with tetraiodothyronine, or triiodothyronine, based upon the number. Tri for three, tetra for four. Note that T3 is the active hormone, even though T4 is found in larger quantity within the bloodstream, indicating that T4 is sort of the reserve, and it has to be converted to T3 for its actions. We can say very little about tryptophan and its product, melatonin, largely because the actions of melatonin in humans are not really all that well understood, although it is linked to sleep cycles and reproductive cycles in many animals. If we jump over here to the lipid-derived hormones, cholesterol is one potential substrate, and that's utilized to produce the steroid molecules. This is one big, long process of enzymatic tweaks, if you will, to modify cholesterol into the steroid of choice. And depending upon the endocrine tissue, whether it's gonadal or adrenal, or in some cases even placental, we can get a wide variety of different steroids out of this similar cholesterol backbone. Another lipid, membrane lipid used to produce chemical messengers, would be arachidonic acid. It's a fatty acid that can be converted into the eicosanoids. It's a very complex pathway leading to the production of a very large number of molecules. These are largely autocrine and paracrine, so we won't put them into the classic endocrine function, but they're very involved in things like blood clotting and inflammation that are obviously very important physiologically. Note, all of the lipid-derived chemical agents from either cholesterol or arachidonic acid are lipophilic. This means that they can enter the cells, their target cells, and bind intracellular receptors. The last group on the right here is the largest group by far in terms of number. We're going to collectively call them peptides, even though they can be both small and large in size. Peptide is a generic term for a relatively short sequence of amino acids, less than 50 amino acids. These are all made by transcription and translation from DNA. And notice we're going to generically use the term peptide, even though we would have peptide, protein and even glycoprotein hormones in this group. So a protein is simply larger than a peptide. A glycoprotein has carbohydrate groups attached to it. And again, quite a variety in this group. All of them are, we notice, hydrophilic, so they will bind membrane-bound receptors to generate their actions.